Good morning and welcome to Plaas TV. Wetlands are the closest thing to the Garden of Eden. As a kidney of nature, they transform substances generated by human activities, make chemical circulation and purify water quality. It also provides habitats for so many organisms. Tomorrow we celebrate World Wetlands Day, so today we will focus on this distinct ecosystem with Dr. Althea Grindling from the Agricultural Research Council. We also chat to Dr. Mohammed Abdel Basit about peat fires. But first, back to you in studio, Lisa.
Welkom bij vandaag se nuus. Volgens die oeskassingskomitee beloop die geskatte oppervlakte onder mielies vir die huidige seisoen 2,7 miljoen hektar. Dit is 6,3% minder as wat verlede seisoen aangeplant is. Die voorlopige oppervlakteskatting vir sonneblomsaad is 5,40% minder as die hektare wat die vorige seisoen aangeplant is. Sojaboonaanplantings verwag 'n reuse toename van 14,3%. Dit is die hoogste oppervlakte beplant met sojabone in die geskiedenis van Suid-Afrika. Dan toon 'n opname van die Suid-Afrikaanse Makadamia Kwekersvereniging dat 2020 se oes 17% laer as die 2019 oes was. Dit was egter 4,5% hoër in die vierde kwartaal vergeleke met kwartaal 3. Klimaatsverandering en vooral ongunstige toestande tydens blom en vroeëneutontwikkeling, sowel as insekte en siektes, het 'n rol in die afname van die 2020 oes gespeel. Lizelle Pretorius gesels nou met ons hieroor.
Alisa, op hierdie stadium is het nog baie vroeg om 'n vooruitskatting te maak. Ek bedoel, dis Januarie, maar ons glo dat die gevoel daar buite is dat dit 'n beter jaar gaan wees in vergelyking met 2020. En ek sou sê 'n baie rawe skatting is ongeveer 15% hoër oes in 2021 in vergelyking met 2020, maar ons sal 'n baie meer beter en akkurate oesskatting kan gee teen die einde van die eerste kwartaal. En dan sal ons beter verstaan, jy weet, wat die totale som van die prentjie was. So ons hoop om in daai tyd 'n beter oesskatting vir 2021 te gee.
En so sê Lizelle Pretorius, sy is die hoofuitvoerende beampte van die Suid-Afrikaanse Makadamia Kwekersvereniging. In 2020 het China se vleisinvoere met 60,4% toegeneem in vergelyking met die vorige jaar. Weens die voorslepende Afrika varkpeskrisis van 2018 is 9,91 miljoen ton vleis uit verskillende lande ontvang. Rabobank voorspel egter dat die herbou van varkboerderye in 2020 tot 'n toename van 20% in die produksie van varkvleis in 2021 sal lei. Dit sal die invoere van vleis gevolglik met 30% op 'n jaar grondslag verminder. Dis dan vandag se nuus, maar moenie weggaan nie.
Netafim, grow more with less.
Welkom vanuit Atelier 2 hier by Plaas TV. Ons gesels vandag oor Wêreldvleilanddag. Ja, dit word môre, die 2 Februarie, gevier. En dit herdenk die ondertekening van 'n konvensie van vleilande, ook bekend as die Ramsar Convention, ek hoop ek spreek dit reg uit, wat op 2 Februarie 1971 in die stad Ramsar, Iran onderteken is. Ek gesels met Dr. Althea Grindling, sy is van die Landbounavorsingsraad en so 'n bietjie later gesels ek ook met Dr. Mohammed Abdel Basit oor 'n verdere projek waarby die Landbounavorsingsraad betrokke is. Althea, welkom hier by Plaas TV.
Baie dankie, Lise.
Jy is nou van die Landbounavorsingsraad en jy is betrokke by 'n vleilandprogram wat hulpbronbewaring betref. Vertel ons bietjie meer daarvan.
So hulpbronbewaring is baie belangrik vir ons wat werk by grond, klimaat en water. So ons navorsingsprojekte is gefokus op ons natuurlike hulpbronne. Dink in terme van die grond, die water en die plante groei. Maar dan moet je ook niet vergeet van die dieren en die voels nie. So rondom Wêreldvleilanddag is die klem dan op hulpbronbewaring. En dan kan ons natuurlijk meer mense bewus maak van hoe belangrijk dit is, dat ons holistisch naar dit moet kyk en hoe ons dit moet bestuur. So hierdie jaar weet jy seker is Wêreldvleilanddag se thema is vleilande en water.
Ek nie geweet nie.
So die punt wat ons moet maak is en wat ons moet verstaan is dat water in die landskap is belangrijk. En ons kan nie die reënval beheer nie, maar hoe ons die water ontvang en bestuur en stoor in die landskap is belangrijk en dis hier waar vleilande een groot rol speel.
So ja, vir landbou is vleilande natuurlijk ook van skatbare waarde. So hoekom is vleilande dan belangrijk?
So, soos wat ek nou probeer verduidelik het, vleilande is een uitdrukking van die beweging van water in die landskap. En as ons denk in termen van die vleilandse eigenskappe, daar is hoë organische grond, daar is plantengroei wat aangepast is om in een nat omgeving te groei, en die vleilande kan water stoor. Hulle het 'n waterstoor vermoë. So in terme van dit is het baie belangrik, want in die wintermaande of droë maande kan die water weer stadig vrygelaat word na die stroomafgebiede. En vleilande, meeste van hulle kom gewoonlik in 'n laagliggende plat area voor in die landskap. So dit help ook met die filtrering van water. So die water beweeg dan stadig deur die landskap.
Is daar spesifieke areas in Suid-Afrika waarna jy vir ons kan verwys waar die vleilande voorkom?
O, vleilande kom reg oor Suid-Afrika voor, maar wat jy moet verstaan is dat ons het seisonale sisteme en permanente nat sisteme. So almal dink partykeer in die droogtyd daar is nie 'n vlei nie, maar dis eintlik as gevolg van die seisonale variasie. So daai vleiland kan daar voorkom is 'n vreeslike nat periode soos nou, kom jy achter daar is vleie waar daar nooit eindelijk een vlei was nie, maar het is belangrijk om die areas te karteer, zodat jy ingeligte besluite kan neem. So, nog een funksie van die vlei dan, is behalwe dat hy water stoor en ook water filtreer, is ook die plante groei. Dit kan die vloed van water keer of stadiger laat maak. Maar, nou moet ons ook in context sê, as die vleiland gezond is. So wanneer jy in een opvanggebied water moet bestuur, is vleilande belangrijk. En dit is waar grondeienaars en boere een groot rol kan speel as hulle hierdie processe kan verstaan. So kom ons vat een voorbeeld. As jy een vleiland draineer, dan gaan hy die waterstoorvermoe verloor. Of as jy kyk na opvanggebied en jy bestuur dit nie reg nie. Kom ons kyk een voorbeeld van oorbeweiding. Of as lande gemaak word sonder inagname van die konture, dan gaan jy met intense reënval baie sedimente wat in die vleie inkom. So dan verloor die vlei eintlik sy kapasiteit om sy werk te kan doen. So daar is 'n veerkragtigheid wat ons moet in ag neem. Die vleiland kan doen sekere funksies, maar dan moet jy dit in context sit, waar die vlei gevorm, hoe groot is die vlei, wat se type vlei is dit, en as ek praat van type vlei, jy het moerasbosse, jy het palmietsysteme, jy het riet gedomineerde systeme, so daar is verskillende type vleie wat ons kry, en hulle het allemaal verskillende funksies. So wanneer jy daai drempelwaarde oorskry, dan verloor die vlei sy funksie en hy het sy veerkragtigheid. Nou die veerkragtigheid is om te kan herstel nadat 'n omgewingsverandering was. En dit is belangrik. So as jy gesonde boerderypraktyke het en jy het 'n gesonde vleiland, dan het jy watersekuriteit.
Althans speel wetgewing enigsins 'n rol?
O, natuurlik. Enige aktiwiteit in en om 'n vleiland moet gedoen word in gevolge van nasionale wetgewing en die boere en grondgebruikeienaars moet bewus wees daarvan.
Huidige projekte waarmee julle besig is, net baie kortliks?
Ons het 'n WNK befondste projek waar ons na veenvure kyk. Dit is veenlande, is 'n spesiale tipe vleiland en As gevolg van die droë omstandighede het ons baie veenvuure in die land gedokumenteer en van my navorsers sal ook later daaroor praat.
Nou ja, dit is dan Dr. Mohammed, so bly ingeskakel vir daardie gesprek. Elsie, baie dankie vir jou tyd.
Baie dankie, Lisa.
Nou ja, soos ons gesê het, môre 2 Februarie word Wêreld Vleiland Dag gevier.
Goeiemôre kykers, en vandag se termynmarkverslag kan maar gesien word dat die termynmarkpryse vir grane en oliesade effens 'n oplewering getoon het na die vorige week se skerp prysdalings. Witmelie se prysverlewering in die maart maand is steeds effens laer, 0.5% af. Geelmelie se prys het onveranderd gebly terwyl die koringprys 0.5% gestyg het. Wat oliesade aanbetref, het sonneblomme egter sterk teruggekom met 7.5% prysstygings verlewering in maart, terwyl sojabone se prys met 6.9% week op week gestyg het. Die olieprys het effens teruggesak met 1%, terwyl die rand gemengde reaksies teenoor die vernaamste geldeenhede getoon het, 0.1% sterker teenoor die dollar, 0.5% swakker teenoor die pond en 0.3% sterker teenoor die euro.
Nutrifeeds, die formule vir sukses.
Moving from wetlands to peat or turf, as it is more well known, and in more particular peat fires, the monitoring thereof as well as restoration. That's our discussion today with Dr. Mohammed Abdelbasit, and he's also involved with the Agricultural Research Council. Dr. Mohammed, welcome.
Welcome, thank you very much for having me.
What exactly is peat and what is the importance thereof?
Okay, the peat is partially degraded organic materials. Until now, the people, there's a big debate whether peat can consider it as soil or as a plant or living organism.
And what are the causes of a peat fire?
There is a lot of causes of the peat fire, but the main cause of the peat fire is upsetting of hydrologic condition within the peat land. And that by lowering the groundwater in the peat system, and that causes the dryness in the peat. And then because it's organic material, highly susceptible for fire, so it starts to catch fire. And the origin of the fire could be like veld fire, that fire like a flammable fire, or it can be self-ignition, that the peat itself like start burning.
Mm-hmm. And I believe this is your field of expertise, and that is where the monitoring comes in. So how do you monitor?
Yes, monitoring of the peat fire is quite a difficult task. The reason that peat fire is not like open fire or not like flammable fire. It's the type of fire, they call it smoldering fire. So it occurs usually under the ground. So using, for example, like a traditional algorithm to monitor, for example, the open fire or wildfire cannot work for a bit. For that, we need to integrate various measurements in order to assess, for example, the susceptibility of certain system to the fire as an early warning system, or to identify the areas that's now undergoing some fire incidents. Yes.
And what are the proposed monitoring and the advantages of this monitoring system?
Yes, as a part of WRC Water Research Commission project, in collaboration with Water Science, Dr. Alcia Groening, and also another colleague in the Geoformation Science, Khalid Abu Talib, and myself, we put the platform to monitor, or proposed platform to monitor the peat fire. At the beginning, we try to use the remote sensing, satellite remote sensing, and integrate this with a drone measurement. We measure, for example, the heat emission using thermal infrared cameras that mounted on a drone, and combine it with the multispectral information to also monitor the plant condition and all this. But with the research, actually we start to develop more comprehensive system that involve even ground measurements such as groundwater level or the water table, and integrate also the human reports as well in the system that can help, for example, in more comprehensive monitoring or for the peat system and for the peat fire.
Now, the implementation of this monitoring system, talk to us about that.
Yes, the implementation, there is actually the peat areas or the peat lands is with interest for various departments that include Department of Environmental Affairs, Department of Water and Sanitation, Department of Agriculture. So all these departments can work together in supporting this kind of monitoring platform. And the implementation could be like applied on that system host, for example, by Water and Sanitation Department or Environmental Affairs. And then start to bring all these data, like groundwater data and satellite data and drone data. And by the way, because you cannot use, for example, the drone for the whole country, we made the proposed platform for monitoring that can suit all, for example, all scales. And this is one of the major characteristics of the platform, that it should also consider the scale. For example, in the national scale, we use basically the heat and degradation anomalies. In the field scale or system scale, we use, for example, spatial information, that, for example, satellite as an image. And once the fire is confirmed, then we go for the drone and use the drone to identify the area of no entry, because the peat occur underground and it's very difficult for people to recognize there is a peat actually going underground, and then somebody can trap inside. And there is a lot of incidents before happen, but fortunately for cattle, yeah, because the cattle see the grass on the top and then start walking inside and then trapped inside the peat fire. Yes.
Well, our discussion today is on peat fires. Don't go away. After the break, we'll continue. Welcome back to our discussion with Dr. Mohammed Abdelbasit, and we are talking about peat and peat fires. Key contributors to the peatland protection, what are those?
Yes, thank you for mentioning that, because this is very important actually to take the research, like the platform from the research level to the application level. The key contributor for sure that I mentioned something about them, the Department of Water, the Department of Environment, and the Department of Agriculture. Because with the collaboration of these departments, actually, we can implement this platform, the monitoring platform, very well and efficiently to protect the peat and protect also the water resources, because the peat actually one of the, like, a good system for saving actually the water, and from viewpoint of biodiversity as well, it's quite important system.
Is it possible to restore peatland after it's affected by fire?
So restoration, like retaining the peat back, so that's quite difficult. We need thousands of years to have one centimeter of peat. Mm-hmm. So once we lost it not only due to the fire, if the peat got like dry, actually it loses a lot of important characteristics. For example, the peat can be considered as a hydrophilic that absorb water. Once it gets dry, it becomes hydrophilic and cannot, hydrophobic and cannot absorb any more water. So for that, we need to protect the peat before the fire or before the dryness. So monitoring the dryness of the peat is very important for the protection. For the restoration, the system is self-correction system. That mean once the peat is it like bend, so the elevation of the peat will decrease, then the water will come again on the top. And then we think that the system is recovering. But actually, due to the new elevation that we have it in the system, now we can see the groundwater in the top. But again, with the continuous extraction and decreasing of lowering of the groundwater, what will happen? The groundwater will go down again, dry of the peat, and then it bend again.
Sure.
Yes.
Right. Quite so, a process.
And, yes. Yeah, and then it will be lost forever. We cannot retain it. It needs millions of years. Obvious to get the peat, and there's a lot of studies actually talking about this, like the timing of the peat formation.
Well, in closing, what are the challenges to protect peatland areas?
Yes, a lot of challenges that actually for the, because the peat is actually competing, for example, with municipal areas, competing with agricultural, competing with, for example, forestation, and all these. So the challenge is that now the water resources in South Africa is quite limited. So to allocate water for the peat, so many people, they don't see it as important as agriculture or as a municipal water use. So the peat water, for example, required water for the peat restoration comes maybe in the second or the third level, for example, in the priority for allocation. And this makes the challenges. So the best thing to do is all these sectors talk together. This is number one. Number two, like we can go through, for example, each system has its own hydrological setups. So we need to go and look, for example, for the recharge areas and try to do more projects on that to reduce, for example, the water loss and have more water available for the peat restoration and other sectors.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Now I know more about peat fires and peat land and the protection and the monitoring.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your, yes, thank you for having me.
That is Dr. Mohammed Abdel Basit, and he spoke to us about peat.